Welcome to Polychromatic Dimensions, and I'm your host, Hideko Mills. And I have with me Dolores Catherino. Dolores and I have worked together in the past on various projects, and I've always been really fascinated as to how you came to where you are right now. Tell me more about your family and your history of music.
My parents, my mother was an artist. She was very much into all of the visual arts. She could do drawing. She did painting. She got into sculpture, just all kinds of artistic things. And she was always that person that was saying, you know, never do your art for a living because it takes too much out of it. You make too many compromises. So she was always the practical one that was saying, you know, keep going to school, have something to fall back on. And then my father, on the other hand, is an a theoretical electrochemist.
Oh, my.
So he's a PhD scientist. He went and got a law degree and a CPA and always studying. But he was the one that was saying, you know, art is what makes life worth living. And so if that is your passion and your calling, then that's what you should do. So I had those kind of competing, the practical and then the very philosophical view of where art would fit in life. I didn't really get involved in music. They did the little fifth grade, you know, 3-month thing with the flute. And all I remember about that is I spent my whole time in the band laughing because it sounded so bad. So I did a 3 months. I'm like, here's my flute. I'm done. But right around the same time, they started sending us to the roller skating rink because in the 70s, that was a great way to do the childcare and just send your kids there for the whole weekend and have them get great exercise. But what I really enjoyed was listening to that 70s music with all the speakers in the roller skating rink. They must have had, I don't know, you know how big a roller skating rink is. I'm sure they had at least 8 speakers.
Oh, my.
So you kind of had this surround sound stereo thing and you're getting your exercise and hearing all of these wonderful mixes. And it's funny that it's, I don't know if you remember on the radio when they started doing the processing on the oldie stations, that all of a sudden, it's like these sound nothing like what I remember from the vinyl. And one of the telltale signs for me is when the hi-hat is the most prominent thing in the mix.
Oh, right.
It was never that way before. You really had a lot of mid-range, a lot of warmth in the overall sound. It almost seems like hourglass mixes where you have very bright, brittle top end and the super bass, but all that warm mid-range is gone. So that was kind of my musical education, was just hearing all of this great music on the greatest sound system you could imagine in the 70s.
Yeah, speaking of the 70s, you know, I recall growing up in Detroit area, and my folks really enjoyed the range of music from Tchaikovsky to Duke Ellington. And of course, growing up in Motown, we were exposed to lots of amazing music and amazing musicianship. So tell me about some of the folks that influenced you in terms of how you shaped your musical journey. Who are the folks that really moved you?
I think most of all, it was the mentors. So my high school band teacher. I had really just started playing the saxophone right before I got to high school. But I practiced all summer long. I was just totally dedicated to it. And he knew that I hadn't been playing very long, so I had an aptitude for learning instruments. And he said, you know, in a jazz context, usually the sax players triple. They play clarinet and they play flute. So very encouraging to keep starting over, to keep going. And that process kept me from, you know, how you can kind of get an ego on an instrument when you achieve a high level of expertise. The idea of starting over and sounding really bad is just too much.
Right.
But for me, because I just started, so I wasn't attached to being a sax player yet, a good sax player, that starting over was fun. And then they all seemed to integrate because you just realized you had a broader perspective of woodwinds. And so in college, same thing, the chairman of the music department, he was very encouraging because he was working till all hours of the night and he would hear me practicing.
Sure.
At midnight. And so he called me into his office and he would work with me to create my own degree.
Wow.
Because I was so interested in different things. And the only way that you could study different instruments as an undergrad was to be in music ed. He allowed me to take classes and just put together a degree. And that kind of flexibility was something I really hope to carry forward for other people.
And so who are the artists that you would listen to as you were kind of coming up? Were you captured by any particular style?
You know, most of my musical background was from, like I said, the roller skating rink. Mm-hmm. And so by the time I was practicing an instrument and not going to the roller skating rink, all my time was spent practicing. So I wasn't listening a lot. Mm-hmm. I remember in Detroit, WJZZ.
Oh, yes.
And when they started going over to the, what was that called? Not modern jazz, but it was almost like pop jazz where they had kind of the drum machine underneath.
Yeah, commercializing it. Yeah.
In high school, I was so blessed to have been in the same time and place as Bob Hurst, who fantastic bass player, played mm-hmm. on the Tonight Show Band, played with Wynton and Branford Marsalis and a lot of different people. And so he was really inspiring to me because it kind of brought me into the jazz world. And so just talking to him here and there, you know, I started listening to John Coltrane and Charlie Parker and Michael Brecker and, Dexter Gordon and Gene Ammons, a lot of sax players. But it was after the point where I already kind of had my sound.
Sure.
I could just really appreciate the different timbres these artists got on their horns.
Mm-hmm. You know, back in the day when I was playing out and about in the Detroit area, for example, I'd work with artists that were folk artists, R&B, jazz fusion. And one of the reasons why I appreciated jazz fusion is it sort of encompassed all of those styles in one way or another. And it seems to me that, you know, the use of a fretless instrument like the fretless bass, you really can sort of move within those microtonal circles from an instrument, execution of an instrument standpoint. And so one of the things that I've seen you use from time to time are instruments, what looked like had a keyboard footprint, but there were no keys on it. It's as if you can swipe your hands across it to make sounds. So what is the name of that particular instrument?
Oh, that's called the continuum fingerboard. And I don't know if you remember Kurzweil. I guess back in the 80s or 90s had a ribbon controller.
Oh, yeah.
But with the continuum, you could have one pitch for each finger at the same time, and you could go front and back as well as side to side. And that it remains the most difficult instrument that I have because of trying to figure out the intonation. Because when I started on fretless bass and I started playing two or three notes at a time, it was all about trying to get a precision of everything being exactly in tune.
Mm-hmm.
And with the fingerboard, and, you know, even if you're trying to do three and three, six pitches at once, there's just, it's too much information to figure out, okay, what exact pitch do I want each of those six to be? So I'm not there yet. But I think that doing the fixed pitch keyboards just gets my ear better so I have a better sense of exactly what I want. And then I can work on the technique after that part is developed, I think.
Sure. You know, one of the things that I appreciated about, for instance, Motown is they certainly cranked out a lot of hits, but you could tell that there were humans behind those instruments, particularly when you're kind of playing either behind the beat or slightly ahead of the beat or using a fretless instrument, for example. You're not quite exactly on the note. Which kind of, you know, if done, I guess, for lack of a better word, successfully, it really does change the feel of the end result, the song. You know, I'm really curious as to, besides the stringed instruments, we talked last time about the microzone instrument that you have that's behind you at the moment. And I was wondering about the assignment of, you know, pitches. So can you talk a little bit more about how you assign pitches to each key? I'm presuming it's called a key. And whether or not you can actually assign different pitches and or tones.
So when you have a MIDI device, a keyboard controller that has more than 88 notes on it, or as I would say, 88 key switches, then you start to run into problems with MIDI running out of note numbers on each channel because you only have 128. So with the microzone and tonal plexus, you can end up with hundreds of key switches on a single controller. And this is where the complexity comes in of how you would efficiently allocate all of these note numbers among 16 channels in a way that's intuitive somehow. There's basically two different approaches to the problem. One involves the use of micro pitch bend. So you're using all 16 channels and every note that you hit on the keyboard is sending a command through a pitch map that alters that pitch with pitch bend, with micro pitch bend.
Sure.
And the advantage to this is that any sound module that recognizes pitch bend on all 16 channels is able to run this type of a scheme. The other approach to the problem is where you use tuning files or Scala files. This is a bit more limited because you have to have a sound module or a sound device that's creating your sound patches that can read this type of file or these type of scripts. The advantage of that format, though, is that within that limit of 128 possible note numbers, you can run everything on a single channel and you don't need to use up to 16 channels. A problem for me with the editing with the pitch bend method is that it's randomly assigned to MIDI channels. So if you're trying to do any editing, the phrases and the notes are dispersed randomly over your 16 tracks if you're running each channel on a separate track. So editing is just incredibly tedious and cumbersome. So those are the two basic ways you can go at it. They're both pretty clunky right now, because the system was never designed to do this kind of thing. Even on a full electronic keyboard, you're up to 88 notes. But now with these microtonal keyboards, you're way beyond 100. So, and with the tonal plexus, beyond 1,000 key switches. But as MIDI 2.0 comes online and MIDI polyphonic expression, which is designed for instruments like Roli and the Linstrument, where each note that you play can have its own independent expression. So if you imagine a mod wheel, you could hit a chord, hit the mod wheel, it would impact all the notes in your chord.
Sure.
But now with MIDI polyphonic expression, each note that you hit is on a different channel, so it can create its own degree of modulation or aftertouch. So you really have independent control over each finger when you're playing.
So, you know, it must be really challenging in terms of your recognizing the limitations of some of the microtonal instruments, devices that you're using. And I'm curious as to whether or not, say, Roland or Yamaha, it sounds like they may not want to move in that direction because it may not be commercially viable to them in terms of revenue. But there must be other companies or startups that are trying to move in that direction. Maybe they don't have the enormous amount of capital that they need. Tell me of some of the companies that are out there that may be of interest to you in terms of their deviating from what we consider, you know, traditional instruments.
One that's really captured my imagination is Blackmagic Design. Mm-hmm. And they are more in the audio video world. So what they did is they came out with this great video editor called DaVinci Resolve. I think they're up to version 16. Mm. And they give it to you for free. It's a very well-featured video editor. The full version's only 300, I think. It's almost like the loss leader. That's the giveaway because it's well integrated with their hardware system. So they sell cameras and all kinds of AV equipment. Mm-hmm. And so recently I was looking at AV switchers in a podcast situation, and Roland just came out with one. We saw it at NAMM. It was $1,500. And then I saw that Blackmagic Design came out with an ATEM mini controller, and it's $300. How does Roland compete with that? Because A, not only the price point, but B, Blackmagic Design has been developing all of this top level software for audio and visual integration. And I wondered if companies like Yamaha, Roland, Korg can go in that area. I recently was just searching online and discovered it's been a while, but Yamaha bought Steinberg. And Steinberg creates Cubase, Nuendo, Wavelab. But if you go on the Yamaha website, you'd have no idea that they're even in that realm.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't associate Steinberg with Yamaha at all. And maybe that's because Yamaha does not have a name in that area. They're not known as a software company. Mm-hmm. So they want to keep Steinberg's reputation, and so it remains Steinberg Cubase. But at least they're trying to make that crossover. They haven't really created the instruments and controllers that would dovetail nicely into Steinberg software. But maybe that's the direction for the future. If you go online and you look up these corporations like Korg and Kurzweil and so on, and you just see that there's really nothing that really catches your eye on what's the next generation. They're kind of stuck in this limbo right now where they're creating the hardware. We'll see how they implement the new MIDI 2.0 and then trying to tie it into this bigger community of audio visual. How do we get all of these things integrated and create the software to make these new instruments do amazing things? Like maybe the next generation of keyboard would have this AV switcher built into the keyboard. So when you're performing live and you have visuals on the stage, you're able to cue these as well as being playing your parts, you know, that kind of integration, I guess.
So definitely multidimensional in terms of the human sensory systems, right?
Yes.
And we were talking before about charting out your compositions and the use of colors in addition to the typical notes, you know, for example, F and then F with a blue, F with an orange. And so it really does sound like that is an area, you know, I'm kind of relating it to when you would mix music. Typically you mix for stereo, but you can also mix for quads and in spaces and so forth. And it's almost a virtual or augmented reality experience for music. So it sounds like what you're doing is actually moving in that direction. And then the software that you're referring to, the DaVinci Resolve, may give the opportunity to have a full blown augmented reality experience of entertainment.
Right. The question is whether the audiovisual companies will be the ones that create these great innovative musical products as a subset of the AV production or the virtual reality production versus these music companies that are trying to get into more innovative software and integrated software, but it's still music. It's only music. Mm-hmm. And when you're talking virtual reality, augmented reality, there's a visual component. It is multi-sensory.
Sure.
So maybe that's the momentum is going to come from the other side, from the AV world and not the music world. And that might be why when we were at NAMM, it was really hard to get a sense of the innovation. Well, except for the Lumatone. I mean, that really stood out at the show as something that was just in a totally different category than everything there.
Sure. So describe the Lumatone for me, because when we were there, by the way, at NAMM show, and that was the first time I've gone, it was overwhelming for me, at least, in that I want to say there were about 150,000 people there across a couple few days. And it was really an overwhelming sensory experience. Tell me more about this Lumatone. What was it about that particular piece of gear / instrument that stood out to you across thousands and thousands of different workstations and instruments and software?
Most of the gear was variations on older designs. Mm-hmm. In the keyboards, an overwhelming percentage still had that linear left to right. And then there was one that was shaped like a circle, so you could stand in the middle of it and play the keyboard. Mm-hmm. But basically, same instrument, just with minor modifications. But then you got to the Lumatone, and it stood out because hexagonal keys, assignable color, assignable pitch. I don't know, it just gave you a sense of this is the future, because we have limited ourselves to 12 pitches. And maybe in the past, that was a mechanical limitation. You could only have so many strings in a piano, only so many pipes on an organ. Mm-hmm. And now with electronic key switches, you have exponentially more pitches at your disposal. But we don't have the controllers yet, or the keyboards, whatever that form of controller will be. They aren't mainstream enough.
So I remember walking by that area and I thought, oh, what lovely art. And it wasn't. And so describe for us what it actually looks like and how does one manipulate the Lumatone?
It has an aluminum casing and then hexagonal keys, which are not in a flat orientation. They kind of cascade upward mm-hmm. as they go away from you. It has assignable color, so you could see the different color layouts they had programmed, and assignable pitch, so you could also hear different scales that they were putting on the instrument. I had pointed out that because it's what they call a generalized keyboard, that means that all the keys look the same. So on a piano, we can tell where we are by the black keys, which kind of sit halfway up and they're a little mm-hmm. more elevated. So you can play the instrument without looking down. You can kind of feel where you are. But on a generalized keyboard where every key is the same, kind of like the microzone, you really don't have a sense. So I was thinking maybe I would put some Braille stickers on some of the keys so I have an idea. I can feel where I am on the instrument. Mm-hmm. And having played the microzone, I noticed a big difference was that the microzone has key switches. So there's very little travel when you push the switch. With this one, it has kind of a lever. They've designed a new lever system. So it gives you more of that feel of playing a piano because there's more excursion of the key.
I see.
So it's a different feel as well, but really a stunning instrument when you look at it because you can program these colors to be dynamic and change. And this is a whole different world. It's a new way of approaching music.
So when are you going to receive this instrument to start playing and experimenting?
Well, the plan is they're going to send me a prototype, hopefully, in March. And I'll be able to kind of figure out how it's programmed and maybe do a video or two about my experiences with the instrument and kind of maybe compare and contrast it with other keyboard controllers I've worked with. And then I think they're going to be going into production sometime in the summertime. So this will be pretty exciting. I'm looking forward to it. It's just, you know, I hate to get too worked up about it because, you know, there's always delays and in production and that kind of thing. So, sure. But they do have the prototype. That's one of the two that they brought to NAMM. So that'll be really fun to kind of get my hands on. And just from this perspective of having tried different instruments.
So did they reach out to you based on your work on YouTube and the TED Talks? Or did you find them?
Initially, I saw that they were doing a funding campaign. And this was, I think, 4 or 5 years ago. So I got in on that to make sure that there was enough interest that they could move forward. Mm-hmm. And what happened was after they got that funding, they continued making modifications to the design because they found some flaws in the design. And this has taken years. So some people were very frustrated by that. And from my perspective, I was telling them that when they actually get this keyboard out, it needs to be durable and work well. And so they've worked out different design issues and they're continuing to update the functionality. At some point, they're going to add aftertouch because you have a lever. So when you get down to the bottom, if you push it a little bit more, there's potential for aftertouch implementation. So yeah, so I got involved with the Lumitone. It took many years and they were still, they finally got all of these design issues updated. And then they contacted me before they went to NAMM mm-hmm. to see if I would, you know, use it, take the instrument for a couple of weeks and create a video. And I didn't think I could do it in a couple of weeks. So that didn't really work out. It really takes a longer time for me to get a sense of the technique on an instrument
sure.
and just the advantages of the way that it's designed ergonomically. Mm-hmm. So 2 weeks was a little too tight. Now I think I'll have a longer period of time. I think they said maybe about a month and then send that back and get one that comes out of production. So
gotcha. Well, I'm certainly looking forward to your playing with it and creating compositions with it and potentially, you know, using it along with your microzone, among other things, right? Is there anything else that you are looking forward to in terms of the, not just the Lumitone, but is there anything else in the horizon that you've got your eye on and you want to, you know, sort of pay attention to as it pertains to the work that you're doing? Other technologies, for example?
Generally speaking, it would just be the outgrowth of virtual reality and augmented reality
yes,
because
yes.
the controllers don't exist yet. You know, with the 3D printers, now it's hopefully easier for people to start making more customized instrument designs.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to imagine what they would look like. I'm excited for that. I wish I was a designer because it would be fun to just experiment with things like, you know, when we think about our shoulders, the way mm-hmm. that our arms move is in an arc. but all of our keyboards are designed like in a linear, like a rectangle. Sure. And you wonder, okay, if we started to kind of do that gentle arc and then design it with a gentle incline from front to back, would that create a more ergonomic environment for using your upper extremities, your hands, your wrists, things like that, you know? And I guess I think about ergonomics because as a musician who's going to spend many, many years practicing an instrument, you want to make sure that it's not going to create tendonitis and arthritis over time. And maybe that's the medical background of just let's make it match the body instead of making the body kind of fit into this construct that's a mechanical design that's very efficient in terms of its mechanics, but not in terms of how your body moves. So
that
we'll
is
see.
Amazing. Yeah, that's a really wonderful idea. Hello, Roland. Hello, Yamaha. You know, it's a really wonderful idea to work with ergonomically appropriate instruments. So in terms of augmented reality, and you're sort of investing yourself into a space that is real virtually and not maybe not so real on the other hand, how would you describe what you're moving toward in terms of the augmented reality? And the reason why I ask is because you mentioned coming from a medical experience, a background in as a PA, a physician's assistant. And one of the things that I remember thinking about when you were moving towards new styles of music is how it'll resonate differently with different people. But even from a healing standpoint, something that could have people experience a feeling of joy, a feeling of higher thinking even. Mm-hmm. How do you see where your music is going to fit within sort of this augmented reality, this spatial reality that is not just left to right, but up and down and deep and back and so forth?
It's almost overwhelming to think of that level of complexity. And something, at least from a medical background, that I've always been intrigued by and watching is the use of sound in medical therapeutics. So if you have a kidney stone, they have lithotripsy, which is sound waves that bombard the stone and break it up. And then for a while, they were using focused ultrasound ablation to get rid of tumors like fibroid tumors. There's so much more to sound wave therapy. It's at its infancy. They went into laser therapy pretty quickly, and they're finding that sound waves, in some cases, can do a lot less damage than a laser. As we get older, we notice you have those little floaters in your eyes. And the first thing that comes to my mind is, why isn't somebody using some kind of sound wave to dissolve the eye floaters so you have that clarity of vision? And so I talked to an ophthalmologist, and he's saying, well, we use lasers, and we can, you know, break them up into smaller pieces. So you just have more of them, but they're smaller. I'm like, that's no solution.
Right.
But, you know, so it's that kind of thing. And wondering at what point the research will be done to see if sound waves can indeed impact these different areas of the body. As far as like the joy and the relaxation and that kind of thing, maybe with neuroscience, they will start more research into that area. It just seems so personal. It's such a subjective thing that I don't know how, other than each person, like, you know, when somebody selects the kind of cuisine that they really like, you have your comfort food, you have food before you're going to get out and have a really intense day of working or exercising. And maybe music would be like that. It's just a self-discovery where you figure out, oh, these kind of sound waves really help me get to sleep or get perked up to, you know, have a long day of very intensive cognitive work.
Yeah, you bet. In fact, I look forward to the point where the augmented reality design that includes audio and visual is essentially tailored to each individual for various medical issues. You know, those of us who might suffer from anxiety, those of us who may have issues with bright lights and so forth, but be able to customize their augmented reality experience using your approach to music as well. So you've got colors, you've got, you know, visual colors, and then you've got the audio colors that can combine to potentially be beyond therapeutic. Boy, wouldn't that be great? And hopefully no pharmaceutical company is listening at the moment, but.
The beautiful thing is this idea of visual color and auditory color, when you allow them to mix, it's called synesthesia. And there are people that are born with that, and each one, they have different assignments of color and pitch. But then there are people, it's called associative synesthesia. And what that is through your exposure to this integration of sound, color, and visual color, you begin to associate these things and understand them as an integrated unit. And that's really something that, in terms of the education value of the whole polychromatic pitch color system, is this idea of developing that kind of associative synesthesia. Because I think that the experience would be far more vivid if you can easily integrate more senses into an experience. So if your eyes and your ears are really integrated and perceiving these qualities that in English we use the word color, mm-hmm. then you're able to distinguish things on a much more just a vivid level.
Sure. And, you know, just talking with you today, I'm very excited for you in terms of your forward motion and awaiting the Lumitone and seeing what you can do with it. So I look forward to the next time that we get a chance to sit down and talk more. Hopefully we'll have some updates from you on the Lumitone front, and maybe we can even break down one of your compositions to sort of help us understand how you actually put a composition together using the microzone. So thank you again, Dolores, for spending time with me this afternoon. And this is Polychromatic Dimensions, and I'm your host, Hideko Mills, and we'll talk soon.
Perfect.
I hope you can edit that.